All right. Well, it's 4:31, so we're going to go ahead and get started. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining Galileo and GPB Education for our annual Black History Month Civil Rights Movement presentation here, our live webinar for the state of Georgia and whoever else is tuning in. Russell and I are very excited to be here. So just wanted to, before we get started, do a little bit of housekeeping. We are recording this session so that those who cannot be here live will have access to it down the road. So if you are watching the session live and you'd like to watch it again, just know there is a recording coming. And for those of you who are joining us in this recording, welcome after the fact. You'll see on the screen that we also have a Nearpod slide deck, and all registrants will receive a copy of that. And anyone who's here live, please feel free to join the Nearpod. We do have an Escape the Room activity, and so you kind of need to have access to get to that, but I'll also put a link in the chat. So one way or the other will get you into that Escape the Room breakout activity. You're also welcome to join us at our two different sites where our resources are held, at galileo.usg.edu and at gpb.pbslearningmedia.org. So if you are good at multitasking, you'd like to be watching the Nearpod and listening and taking notes and playing on the site and escaping the room, you can do it all at once. Feel free to have all that going at one time. So I'm going to go ahead and jump in and just welcome everyone to Georgia's G2 Guide to the Civil Rights Movement. Russell and I thought it was kind of a fun play on words to call it the G2 Guide, since G2 is slang for getting up and going and moving and getting ready for battle. And so it seemed to really kind of link to this idea of the civil rights movement. And also, since Galileo and GPB both start with G, we just thought it was a fun play on words, the G2 Guide to the Civil Rights Movement. So all the good stuff that we have that we put together for you guys, all free and ready to go. I'm Tracy Wiley with Georgia Public Broadcasting's Education Department. I'm our Education Outreach Manager. We have a team of specialists who roam the state supporting teachers and students in your schools and classrooms. Please reach out to us anytime to support you. We are a state agency. There's no charge for any of our resources or any of our support. And we love to be out and about in the classrooms with you guys doing the important work. And I'm going to let Russell introduce himself as well.
Thank you, Tracy. I'm Russell Palmer. I'm the Assistant Director for Galileo Support Services. And I am the sole Galileo employee who goes out and runs the countryside and works with our K-12 schools, in addition to our academic and public libraries around the state. And I also set up resources and discovery and provide support for Galileo to make sure that everything stays up and working. Tracy.
Yep, you've got a lot going on. Russell and I have presented a few times together at conferences, and so we just like to hang out together and share our stuff with each other and with the greater Georgia. So very excited to be with you again, Russell. These are our session goals. So again, just to become familiar with Galileo and GPB Education's free resources, how to get them, what they look like, how to find your way around. And then we've created a breakout room activity that we thought might be fun. And so we wanted to try that out digitally and see what happens. Just an idea you can use in your own classrooms as an instructional hook or a way to get your kids to explore the resources in a fun and engaging approach. So we're going to start off, Russell's going to start with Galileo and go into a lot of the resources that are available there. And he's going to turn it over to me, and we're going to do a little brief overview of GPB Education's resources. Then we're going to do the breakout room, and then we'll come back together and do some Q&A and some reflection. And that's kind of what it looks like today. Russell, did you want to clarify anything before I jump into the next part?
No, I think that's great. And Bree, given that we're a small group today, please feel free. If you have questions in line along the way, don't hesitate, from my point of view, to go ahead and stop and ask away. Love that interaction in a small group. So that sounds great. Thank you, Tracy.
Absolutely. Thanks for reminding me, Russell. And we'll be watching the chat too. So Bree, if you want to speak up, would love to hear your voice. Looks like we have four participants actually. So someone else is out there as well. But also feel free to throw something in the chat if you'd like. All right, Russell, I'm going to stop sharing and I'm going to turn it over to you.
All right, I'm going to go ahead and post disabled participant screen sharing.
Oh dear.
But it just on your bottom.
I know. Yeah, and we got on early and we were just chatting, weren't we? And so we didn't actually check that. Okay, I'm going to go and I'm going to make you a co-host, Russell. Just give me a moment here. And I think that should fix it. Oh, and Jane is joining us too. So, hey, Jane, welcome.
Here we go. I can share now.
Excellent.
So in just a moment, and Tracy, if you can just clarify that you can see my screen there with my slide, that would be great.
Absolutely can. Looks good.
Thank you so much. Well, thank you, Tracy, and thank you to those of you who joined us today. And just wanted to share a few of the resources that Galileo has available categorically about the civil rights movement. And I put a frame around this. It was interesting. You really get to do a deep dive into your own content when you start to look at things like this. And Tracy, I'm sure you do the same thing, and really see what you have. And you and Galileo really has some amazing resources, not just the Digital Library of Georgia and Civil Rights Digital Library that we maintain, but also some of our core content that's available as well. It's just good and so representative of what's out there about the civil rights movement. So I want to just quickly share, this is the Galileo homepage, and just to let you know that we've made some substantial upgrades to the Galileo homepage. And I just want to do a quick search for some of March, just to show you that we have recently upgraded our Galileo Bento search, and it has new and different content available. We have currently the Digital Library of Georgia. There's also a Civil Rights Digital Library bento box that is available that you can add locally. If you're interested in doing that, let us know. But just to show you, if I go into the Digital Library of Georgia, my search for Selma March provided me with 119 items, and there'll be everything from different types of cartoons, information by the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, the Edmund Pettus Bridge from the New Georgia Encyclopedia. It aggregates a lot of content in one place. We'll look at the civil rights, the Digital Library of Georgia specifically in a little while. But I just wanted to quickly show you that we have made those updates, additions, and improvements to the Bento search. And you can see not only does it find content available to me in the Digital Library of Georgia, but it finds things for me in the newly added Points of View Reference Center. This is the new database that we added this year. I won't be showing that database specifically, but it is in the additional resources that I put in the webpage for you. There are things like articles like Selma Lessons, Struggles Continue, Babylon Scatherers for 50th Anniversary, so news and related articles, kind of taking things forward after the civil rights movement in the 50s and 60s and how we are still reacting to and working toward those goals today. So also the scholarly articles is available, and it's just makes that we just designed a way to make the content a lot more accessible, a lot more quickly. I just want to show you that as just a recent change that we've made. The order of operations I kind of chose to go with today was thinking about things in the same way that a student might approach a research project. And I was thinking about the background, and I thought about the people, the places, and the events of the civil rights movement, and finding that background information. And we use those tertiary resources like encyclopedias for that. And I was just blown away by what I could find about the Selma March and the related voting rights movement here in Encyclopedia Britannica. The image on the lower right, just to share, and I'll go out to Britannica and show you around in a few minutes as well, just to show you how I got these things and how it works. But in the lower right-hand corner, when I first started this in early January, they were already starting to get geared up for Black History Month here. And you see that there was a fantastic featured article in Britannica School of Middle on Martin Luther King, King's daughter, who was carrying on his work. And then when I went in and did some research, just kind of wanting to have a topic, and I looked at the Selma March and voting rights, there are fantastic things like images and background information about things like the architecture of the Edmund Pettus Bridge. I loved that there was this inset map and sort of event timeline of the Selma March available as an item. And these are so great because these items are so easy to print and share from Britannica. and you can just pull that out, save it, and use it in your classroom. Print it out and hand it out to your students if you want them to see these types of things. And then also, I think one of the types of content, and Tracy and I have had some great conversations about this, that teachers in K-12 struggle sometimes to find and use. There's always YouTube, but Britannica has a lot of great video content. And for example, when I started looking at Selma and the Selma March and voting rights, it also provides things like videos of President Johnson addressing Congress on voting rights. You'll find things about current news and features. So just really interesting to be able to go in and really delve into a topic. It's not just a simple encyclopedia anymore. It's hyperlinked. You get all of the different types of information and information resources all in one easy to access place with Britannica. And just to show you, this is Britannica School. And what I love about Britannica is when you first go into Britannica School, you can go to the elementary, middle, and high school areas. So I'll go ahead and just start in middle here. And I can obviously search a topic by going to the search at the top, and I can just pop in here, I just did Selma. And I can choose Selma March, 1965, United States. And you can see that it provides me with images, background information, the graphic that I shared with you all earlier, which you can get larger and print if you like, with these media details. So you see there's the sharing option, the send option, the favorite an item, the print an item, very easily using the icons at the top of the screen that live within Britannica. So that's just a quick look at Britannica and some of the content that you'll find there. We also work with the New Georgia Encyclopedia. And whenever a resource is truly free, I like to point that out. New Georgia Encyclopedia is truly free. You don't even have to log into Galileo with your Galileo password and to be able to go out and get information from the New Georgia Encyclopedia. This was created through a longstanding partnership between Georgia Humanities, Galileo, the UGA Libraries, the UGA Press, and the Governor's Office. And I remember when this was first coming around in the 90s, maybe myself a bit, in print, and now it's available completely and totally online. You can find a lot of background information about the civil rights movement in Georgia and beyond in the New Georgia Encyclopedia. You see, I went and looked for information about Congressman John Lewis, and there's lots of interesting articles there. He was instrumental in the Selma's Montgomery March. You can see initiatives and learn more about initiatives like the Voter Education Project, which was an Atlanta-based initiative established in 1962, which encouraged African Americans to register, vote, and stand up for their voting rights. I loved learning a bit more about the Albany movement, an early part of the civil rights movement in the early 1960s, 1961 and 62, which was an initiative by African Americans in Albany, Georgia, to work toward desegregation in the community. And that was interesting. Albany was interesting because Martin Luther King Jr. went to Albany to try to facilitate some change and marched and other things. And he saw it as a failure, but really his presence there and then the ongoing work of the community did result ultimately in some successes. And soon after, the city removed segregation statutes. So the New Georgia Encyclopedia offers just an excellent online exhibition also entitled Black Leaders of the Civil Rights Movement that you can access. They have a number of online exhibitions, and this profiles civil rights leaders in the context of their accomplishments. But let's take a look here at next at the New Georgia Encyclopedia. And you see already NGE is, I call it NGE, abbreviation city here. The New Georgia Encyclopedia is featuring a civil rights march right here on the page. I'll put that John Lewis right there. And you can search for browse topics. So if you were looking for browse to specific topics within the states, you can also look at things kind of mapped to Georgia studies within the Georgia study, Georgia standards and the Georgia studies and Georgia standards areas in the New Georgia Encyclopedia. But if I just want to come here and search for something, if I wanted to search for civil rights, just to see the resources, I can just put a search for civil rights movement, the Albany Civil Rights Institute, committees on civil rights, the Albany Memorial. But if I click on the civil rights movement, it gives me background article, the images, and link me out to any media related to this, including the photographs that you see here and then the additional photographs that can be clicked on at the bottom of the screen and used in class course. Sorry about that. Then your site will totally lock up on you because you're presenting in front of people. Sorry about that. There we go. So we have some right in here. Sorry about that. And then you also can, there's a validated site, and we actually get a lot of feedback requests. People are often asking us to make small, subtle changes to articles. But if you ever have feedback or you see an inaccuracy or if you want us to consider upgrading something, we often get those support tickets and respond to those. But also just generally when you search, it breaks it down into the articles, the media, different collections that are available. I mentioned the exhibitions earlier. There are three exhibitions here, including the Black Leaders of the Civil Rights Movement that I've shared a bit earlier. And you can see that this is, as I mentioned, gives information and context to the role of different Black leaders in different areas and arenas of the Civil Rights Movement. That is the New Georgia Encyclopedia. Next up, I want to just share some resources where we can kind of begin to, in that research workflow, when we work with students, the next thing we want to find is maybe they need some articles, some things that kind of bring them up to date on the topic or expand on the topic or offer some analysis to the topic. And I want to share with you a resource, the History Reference Center from Galileo. So I'm going to go ahead and jump on over into History Reference Center. And all of our resources are listed alphabetically in Galileo, and I provided direct links to all of them in both the slide presentation and in a resource guide that is at the end of my slides that Tracy will be sharing with you. So you don't have to worry about feverishly writing all this down. You'll have direct links to all of it. So this is the History Reference Center, and the topic that I chose to explore there was another, you know, I really dug into this and I got interested in various topics. And I'm very interested in the Greensboro floor as a topic. And the image that you saw earlier when I was transitioning was an article, was from an article here about Greensboro floor. I will point out that History Reference Center is a database that's available to all libraries in Georgia, whether they be K-12 or public or academic. Again, as I mentioned, that you get the background articles, the scholarly content, some ebook content, and images from the Civil Rights Movement. Again, the image I shared earlier was the Greensboro Four, and what they did, these were four African-American students in, from North Carolina A&T University. In February of 1960, they refused to leave after being denied service at a war in Greensboro, North Carolina. So more protesters joined them that day, and the number of protesters in that World War II grew from day to day over several days. And then protests began around and around in the segregated South. This is sort of a catalyst for the sit-ins within the nonviolent protest movement. So one protester in retrospect, I thought this was a really interesting quote from one of the articles that I read here, called this particular protest by the Greensboro Four the birth of a world map, as it was a catalyst for more nonviolent protests. So it's really interesting material, and you can find, this is even an ebook that's available here about the Greensboro, North Carolina sit-ins that you can access, but there are also multiple scholarly articles available. Let's go ahead and click on this one about the Greensboro Four here, and the short article. I didn't mention this in Britannica, but a lot of the short articles will have read-along functionality, which is nice. We can go into an in-depth article. Participants, Ella Baker, Joseph McNeil, and others. So lots of good content available here about the Greensboro Four that I can look at and explore. Another approach to this, I'm going back to the History Reference Center main page. I find that students like to often browse. And here there are featured history topics like women's aviation. But there are also events and movements. So I can click on the events and movements area here and then browse by subject area of the History Reference Center. and I can see there right away. There is the ability to browse and learn more about the civil rights movement. So what this does is it takes people and topics like Brown versus Board of Education, Civil Rights Act of 1866, Civil Rights Act of 1964, and it will provide me with content from the database, mostly in full text, related specifically to that topic or event. So that is the history reference there. Again, when we're looking for articles and content of that type. Again, as I pointed out, you can browse it and you can get to articles, download them, print them, email them to your students or yourself and utilize them from there. Galileo provides a huge amount of ebook content, and we provide ebook content for people of all ages. And as I was reviewing the ebook content available through for our K through 8 students, there are several collections of ebooks that are available, the K through 8 collection, which you can see I'm referring to here, and our ProQuest ebook central collection. I'll talk more about those. But just the content that they have would be really great. This is a kid's book, but I just was so, as I was preparing for this, I just was so taken away and taken aback by this great book about Rosa Parks. And I love this page. What does it mean to have courage? Could you be brave in the face of danger? Would you stand up for something that's right? That's, I think, that's a question that we have to ask ourselves when lots of things happen. So it's a really powerful message for kids. And one, actually, I shared this ebook with my daughter because I just thought it was so neat to see. I'll go in and delve around with the ebooks a bit. This is actually the title page from this particular ebook. It's from a series called People of Character, Rosa Parks, A Life of Courage. It's a blast-off reader. And you can see the table of contents available here. And like many of the pieces of content at Galileo, you can email it, you can print individual pages from it, cite it. There's a dictionary to help kids out with any big words that they might see that they would like to define. And then there's a link out to the article that will give you a permalink to that particular article or book that lets you get back to it later without a lot of trouble. So again, hundreds of thousands of ebooks for all ages, absolutely including kids. And I just love this little Rosa Parks book that was available. Again, the idea that I'm going to go out and demo in just a moment, both of these resources. We also have ebook central. So when we're talking about working with high school students, there's also an EBSCO ebooks high school collection. But when we're talking about ebooks from Galileo, ebook central is another collection that we offer that's geared more toward the college crowd, if you will, but for AP students or juniors and seniors doing research or anyone needing a reference book. So for example, I found this fantastic book about the Montgomery bus boycott, which is a history and reference guide that you can browse. Just phenomenal content. It's browsable, readable, searchable. So a student is looking for references to a specific person when they're talking about the Montgomery bus boycott, they can find that information about that person by searching within that specific book. So that is ebook central. And just a quick look at both of the resources that I'm mentioning here. This is the K through 8 ebook collection. As I can show you, what the ebooks look like very quickly and easily. One of the limitations I don't like about these ebooks is you can't yet search by Lexile. We're working on that, and we hope that happens at some point. But you see that with my search, I not only get the ebook that I mentioned earlier, which is Here's a Life in Courage, but I get a lot of really good ebooks at different reading levels. Again, that fit that K through 8 reading line, if you will. Sometimes you can find the Lexile information on the title. The front matter of the book, once you go in and view, by clicking on PDF full text, view the full text of the book, you can see that there's more information. So it's loading slowly. Again, this is back to the title that I shared with you earlier. Sometimes the back matter, I love that there's a little glossary in here that gives some basic terminology. Just kind of love quality of some of the ebooks that we have to offer. I'm just looking to see if it said anything about Lexile level on this nearly in, but for some titles it will. This is ProQuest ebook central. I mentioned earlier, I'm just going to do my search for Montgomery bus boycott, Helen Brett. And you can see there are various titles about this, but this is the history and reference guide that I mentioned earlier. A good quality publisher, ABC Clio. I can read the book online and share a link to the book with my students if I like. I can download specific chapters that I love it that I can search within this ebook. So if I'm looking to find specific references to Rosa Parks, which there'll be a lot in this book, I can go through and look at the 46 results chapter by chapter. That is a quick look at eBook Central and the EBSCO eBooks. There's a couple more things here to share, Tracy, I'll be quick. My two last items to share with you are the Civil Rights Digital Library and the Digital Library of Georgia. Collaboratively here within the state, University of Georgia works with a lot of Georgia institutions and museums and libraries, archives, to aggregate content about civil rights into the Civil Rights Digital Library. Civil Rights Digital Library just got a substantial upgrade and works so much better now than it once did. This is an image of, names are escaping me, of course, because I am Charlene Hunter, who became Charlene Hunter Gault, who actually worked for NPR for quite some time. And Hamilton Holmes. They were the first African-American students to enroll at UGA, and they're being interviewed here in 1961 after they attempted unsuccessfully to register for classes. So really interesting context for that image. They both went on to graduate from the university and be very successful and to continue to lead in the civil rights movement. This is what the Civil Rights Digital Library looks like. You can look at collections. I love the events. One of the main things I'm going to share with you all is the events timeline here as I take a look at it. I can go in and click on the events area of the site. I'm going to make this a little bit larger. And you can see that it details year by year the events of the civil rights movement across from 1953 all the way to 1968. So if I am looking for specific events, so I'm looking for 1961, I mentioned that Albany movement comes up right there in 61 and 62. Georgia Tech integration, University of Georgia integration, very interesting topics within the civil rights movement, very powerful and moving topics to see. So this is also searchable, browsable. You can browse the different collections. And there are also educator resources available in the Civil Rights Digital Library that you can use to do lesson plans, online exhibitions here as well, study guides. So you can browse those types of materials within the Civil Rights Digital Library as well. Finally, this is the Digital Library of Georgia. And I'm going to go ahead and show my slide for that just because I'm prepared to do that too. Again, trying to get in a hurry a little bit, Tracy, to wrap up things for you. No worries, Russell.
No worries.
Right on time, I think. As I mentioned, the events browse. One of my favorite collections in the Civil Rights Digital Library, and I'd be, first of all, I did not point this out, the WSB TV news film collection. This is, again, selected news footage from both Georgia and national civil rights events from WSB TV in Atlanta, and range of those dates on that is from 1956 to 1980. You will find some wonderful film clips, speeches, discussions in those WSB TV clips. Great for sharing with students to give them context. This image comes from the Digital Library of Georgia. I was very interested in finding some information on busing in Georgia, so I did a search for that and found some wonderful images of students waiting to ride the bus. This is a bus bound for Morningside Elementary School in Atlanta, and this was part of the city's plan to desegregate schools in the Atlanta area. There's lots of great content. Also, I mentioned the DLG. Both the DLG and the Civil Rights Digital Library have fantastic educator resources, so certainly explore those further. So just a few other resources that we have, some of them that I mentioned, like the Points of View Reference Center. Explore and Surge are always great starting points for elementary and high school students. I mentioned also the Georgia Historic Newspapers. We also have other historic newspaper resources available through Galileo that are just wonderful, great educator resources, certainly about civil rights from National Archives and Library of Congress. So lots of great resources that we have that address the civil rights movement and the state of civil rights today available from Galileo. And that's it for me. I want to say quickly thank you. We'll do questions at the end if there aren't any immediate questions. And I did compile a resource list for you, and Tracy's compiled all of my slides into her Nearpod, and she will be sharing that by email with our registrants after the session. Thank you so much, Tracy. And that's it for me.
I love just watching your presentations, Russell. That is fabulous. I think we all are excited about how Encyclopedia Britannica, those of us who remember actual book encyclopedias, are very excited about Encyclopedia Britannica and how far it's come, trying to get the light.
It's a completely different vehicle.
Yeah.
I was that dorky kid who read his encyclopedia set. No wonder I became a librarian, right?
So, oh, absolutely. Yeah.
I loved reading my encyclopedias as a kid. So.
Absolutely. And I agree, the Georgia Encyclopedia, we use it a lot at GPB as well. We link a lot of our content to the Georgia Encyclopedia, so new encyclopedia. So thank you for highlighting that. I love your ebooks. I've said that before. We don't have very many ebooks at GPB, so your ebooks always just astound me. And you said hundreds of thousands. I was like, oh,
hundreds of thousands.
That's crazy that there are hundreds of thousands of ebooks.
Any topic you can think of. As I started to explore this topic too, it was just so cool to see all the great things on that they dedicated an entire reference book to the Montgomery Boys Prestwick Guide. It's just amazing. There's so much depth of information and something like that.
That is amazing. And I love the text to speech. I love the Lexile levels. So you've got a lot of really great, it's such a rich resource. I mean, it really covers everything, foundational content from encyclopedias all the way to primary sources. So it's always exciting to see what Galileo has for our teachers. So thank you for sharing. So I guess I will share my screen and we'll continue along. And if there are no questions or thoughts, were there any like technical questions or thoughts about how to get to Galileo or anything like that? If there are, please throw them in the chat or speak up.
And certainly if you want in-depth coverage, or if you're listening to a recording and you need to reach out, my email is in the presentation, also about palmer@usg.edu. I'm happy to answer any access questions.
Right, absolutely. All right. So all of our content at GPB is housed at PBS Learning Media. So it's a little, it's not as robust as Galileo, but it's also a little bit easier to get to. So it really depends on what you're looking for. To get to our content, you just go to pbslearningmedia.org. And you'll find this site. It is wide open. I'm logged in, but you don't have to be logged in to access it. You can be logged out and you can still search for all the content and find what you need. So your kids and your parents have really easy open access to it. So just want to make sure everyone knows there are really just two sites that we're focusing on, Galileo's site and then PBS Learning Media, really the only two sites where all this content is. Once you get into the sites and you figure out how to move yourself around within them, they're really simpler than they might look. So just want to encourage, if it looks like it's a lot of content, it's really just two sites and moving around within those sites. So I just like Russell, I did a search as well just to show you what it looks like. I actually put quotes around civil rights movement in our search engine. If you want to look for a phrase, you put quotes around it. Otherwise, you'll get all of the rights and all of the movements. You'll still get some PE stuff in there as well. So I put civil rights movement within quotation marks, and I just decided to search for collections. Which is sort of similar to what Russell did, looking for Encyclopedia Britannica and the Georgia New Encyclopedia and other, the eBook Central. We have collections as well, and you'll see there are 62 that are based around the civil rights movement. So lessons from the civil rights movement, Black America since MLK and Still I Rise, the Jazz Ambassadors, Rise and Fall of Jim Crow, and there's some also very specific ones like Austin and Austin, Texas, and then very broad ones like US history in general. So again, it really just depends on what you're looking for. This is very simple to move through. You just go from page to page, look at the different collections, the Black Church from, of course, Dr. Henry Louis Gates Jr., PBS. You can open any of these and it'll tell you what's in them. So this one has documents and videos and they all come with support materials right there. So again, a very simple, intuitive site to look around. Wide open, or you can sign up for a free account. It hosts all of PBS's national content. So of course, Ken Burns is in here, the Black Church, for instance. You'll have other shows that you may recognize from PBS television, but they've divided them up into small bits and pieces, little segments. So it's easier for teachers to apply them in the classroom. Because obviously we don't want to watch you know, 6 hours of a Ken Burns show in class. So they've cut them into maybe 2 minutes or 3 minutes or 4 minutes. They've paired them with lesson plans, with activities. So they're really grab and go, this very trusted, exciting content from PBS that's ready to be applied in the classroom. So there's the PBS, but there's also the state resources, like GPB creates our own resources, and all of our partner states do as well. So there are more than 300 stations around the country, and we're all feeding our free content into this site. So just know that when you go look for content on any specific subject, like the civil rights movement, you'll find it from all over the country, including the Georgia-centric resources from GPB. I don't want to spend a lot of time on the site because I really want to get into the fun part, which is the breakout. But I do want to make sure you know where to find the virtual field trips, because that's the content we're breaking out of. So here in PBS Learning Media, if you search for civil rights movement or even virtual field trip, you'll find our virtual field trip embedded in here in PBS Learning Media. All the resources are here, the user guides, 5 e-lesson plans for each of the sections. We're actually going to break out of the educational equality section, but we're going to create breakouts for every one of the sections. We're just going to demonstrate one of them today. After I launch this, we'll be able to get into it, but you'll see it's aligned to the standards. You can favorite it, add it to your folder. You can build a lesson around it. You can share the link with your students via Google Classroom and other many different ways to get around to it. And it also will sort of refer you to different resources that are similar to it on the side here. There's a teacher view and there's a student view. So the student view is a little simpler, and there's a teacher site, which we're in. And then there's a student site at the bottom here. So students can also access all of this content. All right, so I'm going to move ahead. I did want to mention as well that GPB also has all this content on our site. It's a little bit simpler. We keep it both on PBS and in GPB, and we've broken it down on our site so that you can just watch the videos or just look at the support materials or just go to Google Arts and Culture and look at the content. So it's laid out a little differently. If you just want to watch some videos, they're here. And as you scroll down, these are all the videos in the learning journey. So, which is very immersive, but if you don't want to dive into it, you can also just watch the videos. You'll see we have our online exhibits at Google Arts and Culture, which is more like a digital museum. And then down here are the support materials. So if you just want to get into the lesson plans or the user guides, you can get into those as well. All right, so let me just pause for a second there and see if there are any questions, because I know I went quickly because I want to get into the fun part, but just see if there are questions about access or how to find your way around PBS Learning Media. And as Russell said, GPB is the same way. You can reach out to me anytime with questions or to invite us to come out to your schools or your districts for free professional learning. We have a team of 3, and all of our professional learning support is free of charge. So we're happy to come support you for pre-planning or post-planning or PD days or after school or, you know, lunch and learn, however we can, even video connections. If you have questions and just want to call me or have a little video chat, feel free. That's why we're here, is to support you guys. All right, let's get into the part I've been looking forward to, the virtual breakout room. So we recently did a session at Georgia ETC, the Georgia EdTech Conference, and we did a breakout room from our Andersonville prison, and it was a huge hit. It was standing room only, and that breakout room has gone out all over the state. So I created another one just for this webinar, and so this is the debut of it. As I mentioned, there are 5 different sections in the GPB Civil Rights Movement Learning Journey, and I've created one for just the second section, which is educational equality. And we're going to look at that one today, and I will also send that out separately with the lesson when we follow up with the email. So here's what it looks like. This particular, all of them, actually, we're trying to make them consistent. They were created on Google Drawing, which is a free resource, very simple to use. And we paired Google Drawing with Flippity, which is also a free resource. So I'm going to go ahead and open Flippity here just so you can see what it looks like. This is flippity.net, free resource, not something that GPB has created or sell, but it's such a great resource for breakout rooms. If you scroll down, you'll see there's a little virtual breakout block here, and it tells you how to create them yourself. There's a demo, and then there's instructions for how to create your own virtual breakout. So if you click on the instructions, they're very, very simple. Just working in a Google spreadsheet, you publish the spreadsheet, you get your link, and you embed it into your breakout room. So again, you can create one of these in a matter of maybe, you know, an hour. They're really not that labor intensive, and they're very simple, and they're pretty nice looking. So this particular one, you know, looks pretty nice. So what I did was I took the image of the room from our virtual field trip, and then I just superimposed these letters with links in the different portions of where they are in the virtual field trip. And then here you'll see all of the locks are also embedded in the image. So the students have to go into each of the locks and answer the questions that are embedded in these six different places in order to get out of the room. So I'm going to go ahead and open up our virtual field trip, our virtual learning journey. So here we are in, to find it, it's just gpb.org/CRM for Civil Rights Movement. So here is our Civil Rights Movement learning journey. I'm going to launch it. And it's this great production from GPB and Godot. And as I mentioned, each of the explorations are set in like a room. And so this is a broken beginning. It's like a barbershop. The second room is a classroom, educational equality. The third room is a diner, a sit-in, so the side of a sit-in. Fourth room is the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. And then the fifth room is our president's Oval Office, it looks like. And then the sixth room is the Georgia Capitol. So each of these rooms has different perspectives on the civil rights movement from a different location, a different series of events. And I chose our educational equality room to base the breakout. So this is what it looks like in the virtual field trip. Each of these little hotspots will take you into a particular exploration about educational equality. So the first one is a photo gallery. The second is Brown v. Board, summary of argument and conclusion. The third is Brown v. Board of Education, Supreme Court opinion. There's a video here. There's a Meet the Little Rock Nine. Ruby Bridges, notable individual, and then analyze some artwork. I did not include the video in this particular breakout since we have limited time and there wasn't time to watch the video, but I did include the other 6 points. So you'll notice that in my particular version, I still have the points are in the same place except for the video. And there are 6 points where they would already be in the virtual field trip. So the way it works is you click on the locks and it takes you to the flippity. And so I'm gonna click on the flippity here. And then it asks you to click on each lock to get started. So I'm gonna start with one. And it invites me to click on letter A, and it means letter A here in the game board. So click on letter A to explore the photo gallery. In 1957, Elizabeth Eckford and 8 other Black students were prevented from attending and integrating Little Rock Central High School in Arkansas. What is this group of students called? So then you go back out to the game board here, click on letter A, which will give you the link to where you want to go. And it will take you into the virtual field trip into that particular section, which is a photo gallery. And then the students can actually look through these photos to try and find the answer to the question. So again, the question is, it doesn't say which photo it is, but gives you some clues. It talks about Elizabeth Eckford and some Black students in Little Rock, Arkansas. So as they go back to the image, they can click on them and start to kind of browse through. Does this look like it might be, you know, an image of some students trying to integrate a high school? Is this one? And it says Elizabeth Eckford. So it's the second image. It may be pretty quickly to find it. And they can read the little caption here. And it says that they were all known as the Little Rock Nine. So you can go back up to the flippity and you can type in, and again, the flippity, you can say it in different ways. So I'm gonna go ahead and type in the Little Rock Nine, but you can also type in Little Rock Nine without the, I even offered the number 9 as a possibility. So any of these will work. Little Rock Nine will also work. When you're creating the flippity, you can put in several different versions of the answer so that your students don't get stumped. So try and be as flexible as possible. So I'm just going to put Little Rock 9 with the number. And if I click the key, that worked. And I am out of this particular, I've opened this lock, and now I can go back out to number 2. So you can see as we go through, not only are the students looking for some information, but they're also moving through the virtual field trip and finding their way through it and learning how to use it. So the second says, click on the letter B. They're going to read a little, you know, a primary source here, the Brown v. Board of Education Summary of Argument and Conclusion. And it says that there are 7 inequalities listed. And it just asks for the students to name one of those that are listed on this in this particular conclusion. So again, I'll go back out here and I'm going to head back out to the actual educational equality. So make sure I get back out into the virtual field trip. It looks like I'm going to go back out of the table of contents here and head, actually, I'm going to go here. So, because it's here in B, I'm not paying attention to my own direction. So click on letter B. So I'm going to go here. It's very simple. Click on the letter B and follow that link. So you can see it's already laid out for the students. It should be pretty simple. There's the conclusion, because the flippity says to read the conclusion. And if they're having trouble, they can click on the hint here, which I also created. And it says the inequalities are listed in the second sentence. So this, again, this is a hint that I did. And you as a teacher can give whatever hints that you think might be helpful. And you can always upgrade this activity depending on how your students are doing. So back to this, I'm going to go ahead and open up the conclusion, look in the second sentence. And you'll see that it says inferior physical facilities, psychological roadblocks to learning, warped development, deprivation of playtime, cold lunches, unnecessarily complicated adolescent development in 7. So those are the 7, et cetera. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm just going to pick cold lunches because it's the easiest to type. And I'll type in here cold lunches. But any of those will work. All 7 of those answers are correct. And if I click on the key, I've opened up the second lock so I can go back out. So you can see how it works. Again, it's very simple, but I'm moving through the virtual field trip, because the virtual field trip has all of these sections to it. I've been a photo gallery. I've read a primary source conclusion from the Supreme Court. Now I'm going to go into another one, another primary source, talking about the unanimous decision in Brown v. Board of Education of Topeka. And the court found that racial segregation in public schools is unconstitutional because it violates which amendment? Now, some students may already know the answer to this, just from if they've been studying, but I also have them give them a clue to click on the speech bubble, because there's a lot of information here in section C, and we don't necessarily want them to have to read the entire opinion because it is a primary source. It is several pages long, as you can see. So we may not want them to have to read all of that, but if they click on the word bubble, there's just this brief little synopsis here, and it does say that it violated the 14th Amendment. So I can go back into my flippity and I can type either the number 14th, or I can type the word 14th, or I can even just type 14th. Again, I made it very, very flexible, but that unlocks number 3. Number 4, click on letter D to meet the Little Rock 9. There are 10 people in the portrait. Who's named the woman who mentored the 9 students and was honored in 1957 as Woman of the Year in Education? So again, just learning more about the people who are involved in this. I'm gonna go back out to my game board, click on D here, and it'll take me into the Little Rock 9 section. There's the portrait. And each one of these people, I can click on them and learn about them, like where they came from, and a little bit more about their lives after this experience. So I see there are 10 people, and I know there are only 9 students. And so one of them is going to be an adult mentor, and that person is Daisy Bates. And so it talks a little bit about Daisy here and talks about how she was honored as the Woman of the Year in Education in 1957. A little bit more about her, the only woman to speak during the March on Washington in 1963, a little bit about her background. But I can go ahead back out to my game board and I can type in either Daisy or Daisy Bates or Mrs. Bates. Again, I put in lots of possibilities. Unlock lock number 4. Lock number 5, click on letter E to meet Ruby Bridges at age 6. She was the first Black student to attend William France Elementary School in which city? So I can go back out to the game board, click on E to learn about Ruby. It'll pull up that section about her. And the hint is, again, just a simple hint. It tells you to click on the photo. So it's also kind of giving you some navigation about how to move through the virtual field trip. Tells you where to find the answer so kids don't feel a little overwhelmed. Let me close out some of my open boxes here. It's a little less confusing. All right, so here is Ruby. I'm gonna click on her fold, on her little picture, and it tells about her and her story. And it does say that this particular school is in New Orleans, Louisiana. So I'm gonna go back here and I'm gonna type in my flippy New Orleans. You can type New Orleans, Louisiana. You don't have to have capitalization. You can set it to recognize capitalization if you want, but I did not. And so even if students just type New Orleans without capitalization, it still opens the lock. And then the last one is letter F, which is artwork. So the artwork is called Schools Out. The artist is trying to convey that even in the face of segregation, Black children could still thrive when they had what? So we go back out to the game board, click on letter F, look at the artwork. So here it is called Schools Out. It opens up the artwork so kids can look at it. And it talks here about how families and children could still thrive when they had strong schools and communities. So I can go back and I can type just communities, or I can type strong communities or strong schools. Again, several different answers will work. And then I'm done. And it took me 5 minutes and 33 seconds. So if you did want to make it some kind of a contest, you could have kids take a screenshot of this, perhaps. You could have them work in pairs so they're faster. When I did this by myself, it took me less than 2 minutes. So you can, depending on, you know, the level of expertise or fluidity they have, or you can just make it, it can be like an assessment at the end, or you can make it an introductory activity. But 5 minutes and a half to do that much exploration is really pretty minimal. So I think it's a fun activity, you know, to consider for, again, something that you might want to do in your classroom to introduce the civil rights movement. So I'm going to pause right there because it's 5:22, and that's kind of the grand finale of what I have, but wanted to see what people thought about it or any input about things they liked or didn't like. Again, you're my guinea pig, so if there's something that I can do to change it, please let me know.
I'm the only one left, Tracy. I thought that was the thoughtfulness of the game and how it really engages students and engages different learning styles too. I mean, I know there's been somewhat of a dismissive attitude toward learning styles, but there's still some relevance to that. The whole idea that it engages, you know, seeing my daughter, she's such a kinesthetic learner, and this would be way more fun for her than just reading something or reading a book or looking at a few pictures. So it's, yeah, I love it from that perspective. From the parents' perspective, I think it's great. Make it a game.
Yeah, and when we presented this at Georgia ETC, a lot of the participants were like, I want to use this with my teachers, actually, so my teachers can learn mm-hmm. how to navigate the virtual field trip and get familiar with it so they can teach it to their kids. So it can also be an adult activity. It's great. They were talking about for like a staff meeting, using it in a staff meeting.
Yeah. No, I think I'm actually working with a large group at DeKalb County Schools Thursday, and, working with some of their civil sciences staff, and we'll probably mention this. I also love it. It's one of the things, the biggest challenges for teachers in the classroom, even for me as a librarian, it's keeping good quality tutorials and interactive activities up to date. And I think this really, you know, looking for the things that you all provide really gives an opportunity to have that type of thing created for them. Video and interactive content it takes time, it takes instructional design skill. You know, which a lot of our instructors do have, but it's just not always plausible to sit down and make something like this, and GPB does it for you.
Yeah, and actually you could probably do something like this too with Galileo, because you have so many rich resources as well, like just with, you know, Encyclopedia Britannical, or just with Georgia New Encyclopedia, or just with your eBook Central, and maybe have an exploration as well. It's so simple to do. Yeah. Well, thank you for that input. I think we covered everything we intended to, went through all your resources, or just give a nice introduction, you know, to what's available from Galileo. Also did a quick introduction to resources from GPB Education. We played our little breakout room activity, reflected a little bit. And was there anything that you wanted to share before we wrap up, Russell? Anything that you wanted to throw in at the last minute?
No, just always a joy to collaborate with you, Tracy. For those of you who attended, Larry Hall or in part or in the recording, thank you for taking the time to join us. Tracy and I both stressed throughout the webinar. First of all, our ability, our availability after the fact to answer questions. We'll have email contact information for both of us. There we go. And then also, Tracy, I forgot this piece. I certainly, as I mentioned, I'm working with DeKalb County Schools later this week, and I'm available to do that. I like working with larger groups when I can because I am one person.
Right.
Tracy, I'm a little jealous with two, but that's still not a lot when you talk about doing outreach across the whole state. But certainly we can make arrangements to come on site, either one of us, and work with you. I'm happy to do that anytime. Thank you.
Or together, even together.
Yeah. I certainly think we might have that opportunity at Georgia, not Georgia Agency, but at GLMA.
That's right. We applied for another session at GLMA this year. So hopefully we'll get to back together then. Well, Russell, thank you for joining me at 4:30 to 5:30 after a long day. And it was fun as usual. I think we were able to share a lot of content that hopefully can support our teachers. And I always learn from you. So I appreciate knowing more about Galileo. So when I'm out on the road, I can say, you know, guys, Galileo is also free and available and such a great resource.
We appreciate that. I'll be the same. Thank you so much, Tracy. Take care.
Thanks. Have a great rest of your day. You too. Bye-bye.